Violent fevers, men, all ignorance, have talked in ancient tongues, and that when the mystery is probed, it turns out always that in their wholly forgotten childhood those ancient tongues had been really spoken in their hearing by some lofty scholars. So, to my fond faith, poor Pip, in the strange sweetness of his lunacy, brings heavenly vouchers of all our heavenly homes. Where learned he that, but there? Hark! He speaks again, but more wildly now. Form 2 and 2. Let's make it general of him. Ho, where's his harpoon? Lay it across here, dot dash dash rig dash a dash dig, dig, dig. Huzzah! Oh, for a gamecock now to sit upon his head and crow. Gweeku dies game. Mind ye that, Gweeku dies game. Take ye good heed of that, Gweeku dies game. I say, game, game, game. But base little Pip, he died a coward, died all a shiver. Out upon Pip. Hark ye, if ye find Pip, tell all the Antilles he's a runaway, a coward, a coward. A coward. Tell them he jumped from a whaleboat. I'd never beat my tambourine over base Pip, and hail him general, if he were once more dying here. No, no. Shame upon all cowards. Shame upon them. Let him go drown like Pip, that jumped from a whaleboat. Shame. Shame. During all this, Gweekhead lay with closed eyes, as if in a dream. Pip was led away, and the sick man was replaced in his hammock. But now that he had apparently made every preparation for death, now that his coffin was proved a good fit, Gweekhead suddenly rallied. Soon there seemed no need of the carpenter's box, and thereupon, when some expressed their delighted surprise, he, in substance, said that the cause of his sudden convalescence was this. At a critical moment, he had just recalled a little duty ashore, which he was leaving undone, and therefore had changed his mind about dying. He could not die yet, he averred. They asked him, then, whether to live or die was a matter of his own sovereign will and pleasure. He answered, certainly. In a word, it was Gweekhead's conceit, that if a man made up his mind to live, mere sickness could not kill him, nothing but a whale, or a gale, or some violent, ungovernable, unintelligent destroyer of that sort. Now, there is this noteworthy difference between savage and civilized, that while sick, civilized man may be 6 months convalescing, generally speaking, a sick savage is almost half well again in a day. So, in good time my Gweekhead gained strength, and at length after sitting on the windlass for a few indolent days, but eating with a vigorous appetite, he suddenly leaped to his feet, threw out his arms and legs, gave himself a good stretching, yawned a little bit, and then springing into the head of his hoisted boat, and poising the harpoon, pronounced himself fit for a fight. With the wild whimsiness, he now used his coffin for a sea chest, and emptying into it his canvas bag of clothes, set them in order there. Many spare hours he spent, in carving the lid with all manner of grotesque figures and drawings, and it seemed that hereby he was striving, in his rude way, to copy parts of the twisted tattooing on his body. And this tattooing had been the work of a departed prophet and seer of his island, who, by those hieroglyphic marks, had written out on his body a complete theory of the heavens and the earth, and a mystical treatise on the art of attaining truth, so that Gweekhead in his own proper person was a riddle to unfold, a wondrous work in one volume, but whose mysteries not even himself could read, though his own live heart beat against them, and these mysteries were therefore destined in the end to moulder away with the living parchment whereon they were inscribed, and so be unsolved to the last. And this thought it must have been which suggested to Ahab that wild exclamation of his, when one morning turning away from surveying poor Gweekhead, oh, devilish tantalization of the gods,